Hello and welcome to Tata Literature Live, the Mumbai Lit Fest. In association with the NCPA, co-sponsored by Tata Steel and Tata Safari, powered by Godrej and Kotak. We have some very enthralling online sessions lined up for you today and tomorrow before we meet in person at the NCPA, St. Paul's Institute and the Tidal Waves Bookstore on the 27th, 28th and 29th of October. Do check out the full schedule on our website tatalitlife.in. Now on to our second session of the day. This session is presented by Kotak, a walk around the world. How did Chinese food become so popular? From the Arctic to the Amazon, Chinese cuisine is a favorite in locations a significant geographical distance away from China. How did the Chinese palate make home and hearts foreign? And how is it that it is distinctive of where one may be savoring it? Do economies and labor migration play a part in its ubiquity at all? A filmmaker and the author of Have You Eaten Yet? Cheuk, Kwan is interested in exploring how much our food tells us about who we are. In conversation with him is food and wine writer and columnist and also programming director at Tata Literature Live, Antoine Lewis. Over to you, Antoine.
So about 20 years ago, I got a call from a cameraman friend of mine who said, there's this Canadian Chinese guy who's coming to India, who's kind of interested in looking at Chinese restaurants. Will you take him around and show him some of the places? So I said, sure, yeah, why not? I mean, I'm interested in Chinese food and, you know, I know some of the places. And that's how I got introduced to Cheuk, and I took him around, showed him some of the Chinese places, one of which features in his book, Have You Eaten Yet? And one of the things that I found interesting when I got the book was the title itself. As Cheuk points out in his book, Have You Eaten Yet? Is the kind of the phrase that Chinese use to greet each other. It's not hello, hi, it's have you eaten yet? And this actually reminded me of my experience when I was briefly running a Chinese restaurant and it was just outside a little slum. And all the people, when they met each other, would say, khana khaya, which in Hindi actually means exactly the same thing. Have you eaten yet? It wasn't hi, hello, it was khana khaya. So it's quite interesting how two cultures so close to each other but so different have the same way of greeting. Cheuk, welcome to Tata Literature Live. Thank you for being here. I wanted to ask you, why explore Chinese restaurants all across the world?
Well, I love to travel. Ever since my college days, I've traveled everywhere. I even came to India in 1976 for the first time. So, and after that, I've been to India three or four more times. So everywhere I go, I would be hungry for Chinese food. And I would love to have my rice, I would love to have my green veggie, and of course, my home-cooked meal. So I would always go into a Chinese restaurant and I'll strike up a conversation with the owner or the chef. And I would just open the door to the kitchen and say, hey, hi, I'm a Chinese from Canada. I'd love to have some home-cooked food, something not on your menu. Because as you know, the menu in most Chinese restaurants outside of China obviously caters to the local taste. And I wanted something from home. So that's how I started a conversation. I get to know these owners and chefs, and I hear these stories. And I'm really curious of how they came about, how they migrated, or maybe they were born in that place from three generations forward. So after a while, I thought to myself, I really want to make a film about the spread of the Chinese diaspora. And in the same vein, the spread of Chinese culture and Chinese food around the world. And as you know today, Chinese food is pretty globalized. You can find Chinese food everywhere you go. And in my film, I traveled to Tromsø, Norway, in the Arctic Circle. I went to the middle of the Amazon and I found a Chinese restaurant there. And of course, in Mumbai, in Buenos Aires, in Havana and everywhere else. So that's the kind of thing that that prompted me to make this film. And then, of course, 20 years afterwards, during the pandemic, I was kind of looking for things to do, and I thought maybe I should write a memoir. And the result of this is the Have You Eaten Yet book. By way of introduction, what I did 20 years ago, I'm going to show you a 5-minute clip of from my film. And it will give you a very good example of what I did 20 years ago and very good example of what my book covers. And here's the film. Wherever I travel, I always look for Chinese restaurants. I know that not only will I get delicious Chinese food, but inside every restaurant, I will discover a personal story, a unique story of courage, survival, and hope.
I'm myself. That's what I think about it. I am me. Canadian, Chinese, Japanese, Italian, no matter. I am me.
Is that real?
Should I make the noise?
Is that real?
Huh?
Oh!
I always feel like I'm an Indian. Unless when I look at myself, I said, oh no, I'm not. Otherwise, I feel I'm an Indian.
I'm a Trinidadian Chinese. I think that I'm very patriotic towards my country, Trinidad.
Eu sou um chinês brasileiro, mas em muitos aspectos eu sou mais brasileiro que chinês.
Double for local people. Local people like a little bit of chili hot, you see that. And chicken fried, and on top it put some soybean sauce, you see that. And fried it up, you see. It's quite tasteful, you see. It's quite good, you see.
Voilà. Il y a des plats mauriciens aussi. On fait la dope de poisson avec oignon et tomate, l'ail, piment, du thym. C'est un plat mauricien. Ça aussi, je sais faire.
La soupe chinoise, elle est connue de tous les malgaches, en fait. D'ailleurs, tout le monde connaît la soupe chinoise. C'est presque un plat national, on pourrait dire.
Just as wonton soup has been assimilated into the Malagasy cuisine as soup chinoise, the Chinese, over generations, have become part of the cultural fabric of the Big Island. Maybe this is the direction the rest of the world should be heading, a place where cultures and races have intermingled so completely that it doesn't matter where one's ancestors are from. What matters is the life we create for ourselves in a place we call home.
In Turkey, I was the first married, so there are older sisters and brothers. Originally, they didn't want me to marry a Turkish.
There's no national pride in it because we always felt we were sojourning here. The place actually belonged to the whites.
Toche, toche Peru. Che, che, Milu. Gracias, Peru. Muchas gracias, Peru.
Yo, gracias, China, por haber dado gente como nosotros.
It's true. 生长在地球上就变成地球人就好了。这个地域观念呢，实在是很糟糕。
首先咧，好多次我同佢哋講，我而家活到60歲，我有3個國籍，第一係中國國籍，第二係越南國籍，而家我有以色列國籍。咁到底我係咩人？其實好簡單，我係中國人。無論我擁有咩國籍，我係中國人。
Okay, that was really fascinating, and that was extremely visual and really gives you a sense of all the places and all the countries that you got into. When you've done a film like this, I mean, don't you think that writing a book loses out on some of the essence of that visual narrative?
It does, but don't forget, a book and a film are very two different media. I can actually say more in 5,000 word chapter on the subject than I can with a 26 minute episode within my film series. Of course, the visual part is challenging, but I feel that I'm a pretty good writer, good enough to actually describe this scene, if you were, from the film. So I try to preserve a lot of the visual and the emotional elements in the film, but of course a book is a very different form of storytelling. They're both very valid storytelling, but I find the book can be more expensive. It allows me in 5,000 words per chapter to tell a little bit more about history that I would not be able to do in a film, because as you know, it's television. People may turn off the TV if it's not interesting enough for them.
Yeah, actually that's quite an interesting point, because I did get a sense, having watched some of the episodes and reading the chapters, that you do create a different world in the books. There's a lot that you were able to connect over there. And
yes.
Also, I mean, and you brought in a lot more history, I think, and culture into the book than you got into the film. And
right.
You actually do get a sense, especially the emotional sense of the people in the book.
I had a professor friend of mine who teaches Chinese history in Canada, and he told me, he's a big fan of my film. And then after he read my chapter in Canada, he said, the way I described the funeral scene, he said, basically anybody can make you cry by making a very good scene in a film. But it takes somebody who can write well to actually make you cry when you describe in words. So I think it's actually two different media, as I said, and it addresses you different emotionally between a reader and a viewer. So I think you're right in a sense that we are talking about two different viewing. I know that when I was writing, I was really worried about do people care? Yeah. But I think there's different audience. There are the readers who may not really enjoy the film, or he may not have heard of the film, but they would still be able to read about it. And the other thing that I want to talk about is that by writing the book, I put a lot of interiority in my book. In other words, my life. Details that would be boring to a television audience. They don't want to see me. They want to see what I see when I travel, when I see the scenery, or when I have a conversation. But in a book, it's more interior. And my agent told me when I was writing it, he said, Chuck, people don't care where you go or how many countries you've been to. People care about you, because you have a very interesting life, and people care about my my cameraman Kwa, because he has a very interesting life. So I put a lot of my life, my past history, how I am also a member of the Chinese diaspora, how I have traveled the world, and finally settled in Canada, together with the life of my cameraman Kwa, who also came with me for 4 years. And it makes for a very nice reading, because it's a lot of reflection of my life as a member of diaspora. And as a New York Times reviewer said, I see my life reflected through the people I met.
Sure. And Kwa is quite a colorful character, I have to say, in the book. I mean, he gets up to all kinds of stuff and he gets into trouble a bit also in Israel, doesn't he?
Yes, that's very. He's a very colorful character, and that's why I pick him to be my cameraman. And he's also very brave and courageous. We were often told about by my friend Ajay. He said that he was my contact in Mumbai. When he picked us up, he said, "Look, you know, last time a Canadian crew came along to make a film, documentary film in India, the cameraman left the next day because he could not stand the heat, the whatever, in India. But Kwa, he's a great traveler. He went with me to the Amazon. We were in the Arctic Circle. We were in some pretty dicey places, in Cuba, and so forth, and we weather it all. And I look at it as a travel log, but also a very fun way and an adventurous way that we travel, that I want to show the readers that travel is not just about tourist bus driving around a city. Travel is a lot of adventure, a lot of tasting, a lot of cultural interaction with the local people. And of course there are some mishaps, but that's the fun of it. I believe it's that kind of it gives you a very full view of life, life in a certain places that people have not been to. So it's a very nice angle to look at.
Absolutely. So I just wanted to get a sense from you. I mean, you've traveled to so many countries, you've experienced and interacted with the Chinese diaspora from so many places. Did you find certain threads that connected all of them together? Any shared or similar experiences?
I find that this may be a cliche, but obviously Chinese care a lot about the family. And hence you have a lot of my people in the film and in the book sacrificing themselves, you know, running a Chinese restaurant 15 hours a day so that their kids don't have to open Chinese restaurants. Their kids can become engineers or lawyers or doctors. That's part of it that I think is very, very much unique. The second part, of course, is the whole education part. They want the kids to have good education so that they don't have to work as a laborer or to open a restaurant in the service industry. But also, I think very importantly, the Chinese people do tend to keep a lot of their culture. Whether that's in our DNA or whether because we are forced to keep our culture because we're in a foreign land and we might get discriminated against. So in a sense, if you see Chinatown around the world, they're more than just tourist attraction. There are Chinatowns that people live together. They can take care of each other, not just because they can support each other culturally or linguistically, but also because there's an external force in many countries that I can point to. North America, I can point to Peru, where Chinese are discriminated against. So they are forced to kind of bond together and live in a very, what I call ghetto-like place, so that they can also, you know, fend for themselves. in that place. So I think that's both a cultural trait and a necessity to maintain that culture, even two or three generations after, after the first grandparent came to this place.
Okay. It's interesting that you point out that the first generation doesn't want the second generation to follow in their footsteps, because that's quite the opposite with the Indian experience, where, you know, you set up a business and you want the next generation to get into that business. And in many of the migrants, actually, that is a problem, because the children don't want to and the business has collapsed. But you're saying with the Chinese, it's just the opposite.
I would say, you know, most of the time, the children don't want to continue the Chinese restaurants. And I think the one way they've done that, and in many places, is that they get somebody from their own village to come immigrate to this place, to this local place, to take over the restaurant. And that's the story that I had, for example, in Canada, mm-hmm. where the owner came as a 12-year-old boy, and then he ran the business for 40, 50 years. But none of his kids want to take over the restaurant, and they became doctors and lawyers. And so what happens is that he went to China. He wanted that to continue. So he went to China and offered for sale his restaurant to a new immigrant couple. And so they came over to take over. So I think you get a lot of stories like that. In I'm not sure about India, but I certainly get a lot of stories like that in other places as well.
Okay. And just to go in the opposite direction, in which countries did you find that there were things that were so completely different between one Chinese community and say from Brazil or South or Madagascar or India, something that was completely unique that you didn't see anywhere else?
I would say the most unique place is, to me, is Havana, Cuba.
Mm-hmm.
Cuba had about 125,000 men, laborers, who came in 1920s to help with the sugar plantation and so forth. And the if you do the math, Cuba has about 1 million population at that time, let's say. If you inject 125,000 able-bodied men into the society, and these men, after they work off their indenture contract, cannot leave because they don't have money to go back home, they cannot bring their wives in or the woman in, what do? They intermarry with the local Cubans, be it Spanish, be it Black. So there's a saying in Cuba that a true Cuban is one-third Spanish, one-third Chinese, and one-third Black. It's a very, very mix of a Chinese population. In the 1930s, there were, for example, the Havana was one of the biggest Chinatowns in the world, together with Lima and San Francisco. So three biggest Chinatowns in the world outside of China is in Havana, Lima, and San Francisco. And Chinese were everywhere. Even people who are half-blooded, they might marry, their father might have married obviously a Cuban. But you see that they preserve the culture very well, even for a lot of people who are in second, third generation. And in the 40s and the 50s, before the revolution, there were Chinese opera, Cantonese opera tropes everywhere in Cuba, just to help people, service the Chinese population. That's how many Chinese there were in. There were like three generals in the Cuban army that fought with Castro that are Chinese Cubans. So, and then of course there's Alfredo Lam, who's the Picasso-like impressionist painter who went to Paris and became a very famous impressionist. He's Chinese. So Chinese is in a sense very seep into the blood of the China, of the Cuba island, and it's almost you know, they're proud to have that Chinese heritage, and yet they're totally Cuban. So this is where I find is very different from other places, where like the North America, for example, where Chinese tend to stay more together until recently. So this is why I find very distinctive about Havana.
Okay. I'm glad you mentioned Lima, because I think I see a little bit of an overlap in the Cuban experience in Peru as well. I mean, the world now knows about Nikkei, which is Peruvian Japanese cuisine. Nobu's made it a global phenomenon. But reading the book, it seems to me that chifa, which is Chinese Peruvian, is a lot more organic. It's as a cuisine, it seems to have kind of assimilated far more closely into Peruvian, and it's almost indistinguishable from Peruvian cuisine. I mean, will you tell us a little bit more about that?
Well, there are people who say chifa is the national cuisine of Peru.
Okay.
If you think of Peruvian as ceviche and maybe a few other dishes, most of the dishes you find in Lima, Peru today are evolution of Chinese dishes. There's a national dish called, they call it a national dish, lomo saltado, which is stir-fried beef with green peppers and Peruvian peppers. And it's very popular, and people call it the Peru's national dish, but it's Chinese in origin. It's stir-fry in the wok. So in that sense, Peruvian, the Chinese cuisine has seeped so much into the Peruvian cuisine that it's almost indistinguishable. The word chifa comes from a Chinese word called cifan, as in, have you eaten yet? So okay. This is what happened in Lima Chinatown when the Chinese see each other in the morning or around lunchtime, they would ask each other, have you eaten yet? And the Peruvian would hear this in chifa chifa, as in eat rice. And they would say, oh, that's chifa. That's what Chinese eat. So let's call this cuisine chifa. So the evolution of that is the fact that chifa is now kind of everywhere. Half of all the restaurants in Peru are Chinese restaurants.
Okay.
Or chifa restaurants. Even those who are not Chinese will pretend they're chifa, so they put up chifa menus.
There's also a dish in Madagascar, which is the wonton soup is the national dish. Is that what you mean?
Yes, that's right. Wonton soup came in the 19th century, and it's called soupe chinoise, which is French for Chinese soup.
Okay.
And it's basically a national dish. People eat it for morning, lunch, dinner. It's a very, very popular dish.
Okay. I'm going to bring you a little bit more eastward into India before we get into the Q&A. You travel to Calcutta and Bombay, and this is a big debate in India, at least. Which do you find to be more representative of Chinese cuisine, the food in the Chinese food in Bombay or the Chinese food in Calcutta?
I would have to put my bet on Mumbai.
Yay.
The reason for that is, You took me to Kam Ling. You took me to Ling's Pavilion. I find these places very authentic Chinese compared to Calcutta. Because in Calcutta, which is where most of the Chinese started from, is the Indo-Chinese cuisine is almost like chifa. It's very localized. It's a lot of gravy, a lot of more like curry, and then so it's almost blend into the in many ways the Chinese cuisine. However, that's because you have a much bigger population of Chinese in Calcutta, and that preserved the culture for many years. But in Mumbai, you have a smaller population. So they tend to stand out a little bit more. And they, and of course in Mumbai, probably because you have more diplomats in here or whatever the case might be, there is a bigger demand for what I call authentic Chinese food. And that's, I find that in Ling's Pavilion, run by Baba Nili Ling, I find one of the most authentic Chinese food I've ever tasted around the world.
Okay, fabulous. So I've got a couple of questions from readers who have kind of actually got your book already. And one of the questions in which something that I wanted to ask also is, you know, Indians and Chinese migrated abroad at about the same time, but Chinese food has become very, very popular, but Indian cuisine has not really caught on. I mean, do you get a sense of why Chinese food became so big and Indians, I'm not sure whether this is a perfect question for you, but and whether you'd like to think about it.
Well, I'm not a food writer like you. So I'm having to kind of go back. But before I said that, I want to say that Indian, Chinese, and Jews are the most diasporic people in the world. Mm-hmm. Everywhere I went to South Africa, and of course, I went to Caribbean. There are Indians. And then, like you said before, around the same time, in a lot of Indians went to these places as indentured laborers. And then they stay behind and have a community, all the African communities, for example, in Kenya, Uganda. Those are all from 19th century migration of Indians. As to why Indian cuisine does not take off, I think maybe it's the Chinese way of doing things, that the cuisine wise, is I think a little bit more quick and dirty than the Chinese. Than you know, you can do a simple Chinese meal without all the elaborate steaming or whatever it may be, just with a wok, and you can create a lot of things, very different things, with different ingredients and very adaptable with a wok. You can stir fry anything together. So right. I think that becomes very, very popular and easily adaptable. In the meantime, you know, Indian cuisine, I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, you know, you have a lot of, if you're making a curry, you have to grind a lot of ingredients and you have a very elaborate, and it's not easy to do well. In that sense, I think maybe that could explain. I'm not a food expert, so I cannot tell you, but I think that may explain the thing. The other thing I want to let you know is that I found out that when I was traveling in Peru, that Chinese introduced rice to Peruvians back in the 19th century when they were working at the haciendas or the farms. And they had to feed themselves rice. So they taught the Peruvians how to grow rice. And now rice is the national kind of diet in Peru. And that's because Chinese introduced rice into Peruvian diet.
Okay. Another question that I have is, and something that you touched upon earlier, actually, is there a secret code to ordering authentic Chinese food at restaurants? I mean, you've got the regular menu, and then, like, you know, there seems to be a certain way to get the Chinese food that the Chinese eat. What's the secret?
Well, the way to do it is, first of all, you go to restaurants where there are a lot of Chinese people eating. The second rule is that you ask the waiter. You say, look, I don't want to order from this menu. Can I? Because usually sometimes the Chinese restaurants have posted these menu in Chinese writing, like what's fresh today and what's available today. And they do that because they want to protect the customers. They said, if I show these to the customers, they won't eat them because they're either not adaptable, their stomach won't take it, and so forth. So if you want to order authentic Chinese food, you go to the waiter and says, oh, look, you know, I like to see what they're having eating next door with the Chinese people. Maybe I can order some of these. So ask for recommendation. That's my way of doing it. And yeah. I just want to say something about Indo-Chinese cuisine in Toronto. As you know, there's a huge India diaspora in Toronto.
Are you going to talk about the Hakka cuisine?
Yes. Yeah. Okay. And there's, of course, a lot of Hakka from Calcutta who have migrated to Toronto, and they run this Indo-Hakka cuisine, which is basically Indo-Chinese in restaurants with names like with very familiar names like Frederick and Waldorf. These are all names borrowed from Calcutta and Mumbai and brought to Toronto. And if you go to these restaurants, you see a lot of Indian people eat.
Okay.
Because that's the Chinese food they know from home. This is the Chinese food they know where they're from in India, and not the regular Chinese food. So in that sense, you know, that it tells you the link between food and the home, the comfort of home. You know, that, and that's where a lot of my book is based on. It's about identity and food and home, and finding a home, you know, finding food that is a home cooked food, comfort home. So that's kind of a conceptual relationship that I explore a lot in my book.
Okay. And we've got time for just one question. And how well do different generations of Chinese who've migrated at different points of time, how well do they get on with each other?
Generations wise, they're okay. There are a lot of tribal that don't get along. As you know, China has many regions, and most people would know Hakka in India, for example. There are special type of people, kind of people. And then there's Cantonese, and then there's Fujianese. And I was told in Calcutta, the Cantonese and the Hakka people don't get along. They fight, and they have the you know, just some stories I've heard, you know. So in Calcutta, for example, the Cantonese, the Hakka tends to be in the tannery industry, and the Cantonese tends to be in the woodworking industry. So there's a whole distinction between where you're from and what kind of profession you inherited.
So the differences are more regional rather than generational.
More regional and linguistic, of course. They speak Hakka and Cantonese, a very, very different language. So in that sense, it's very natural for people to say, I congregate, I associate it with people that speak the same language as me.
Okay. Well, Cheuk, we've kind of completely run out of time. Thank you so much for being with us. I can completely understand why you have been compared to Anthony Bourdain in the way that you have created this aura of Chinese restaurants and kind of got into the whole culture and the history of Chinese restaurants for us and taken us on this marvelous journey. All I can say is I'm really glad to hear that Bombay does great Chinese food. And so finally, I'm going to say that, well, if you haven't eaten yet, please go out, eat Chinese food, read Cheuk's book. You're really going to enjoy it.
Thank you so much for that thought-provoking session. A big thank you to our audience for joining us online today. This would not have been possible without our sponsors. Title sponsor Tata, in association with the NCPA. Co-sponsors Tata Steel and Tata Safari, and powered by Kotak and Godrej. This session was presented by Kotak. Our next session online at 8 p.m. is The Play is the Thing, the Theatre of Resistance in Palestine. See you there.